that means we have power, we have sound. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you. Thank you very much. Welcome. Welcome, students. This, as you know, is the Morgan Lecture, named for the gentleman who just raised his hand in the front row, Lawrence A. Morgan, member of TJ's class of 1953, TJ teacher, headmaster from 1980 to 2000, world traveler, resident of sunny Tucson, and lots of other things as well. It's always great to have Larry back, Larry and his wife, Nancy. Since it was started, this Morgan Lecture Series has brought forth a really wide variety of topics, and they've been delivered, as many of you will recall, by an eclectic group of scholars and artists and characters. In recent years, nearly all of the presentations have dealt in some way with important questions related to race, identity, or culture, and today's Morgan Lecture continues that tradition in a very special way. 1948 is my starting point in introducing today's speaker. His own starting point will be well before that. But I'll begin with 1948, which was not long after the end of World War II. And it was in that year that Bernat Rosner, our speaker, arrived at TJ. He will tell you how that happened, and it really is an amazing story. Suffice to say, he was one of our school's pioneers. He graduated in 1950. From there, he went on to Cornell University and Harvard Law School. He became a U.S. citizen in 1953. And up to the time of his retirement in 1994, he served as general counsel for Safeway Stores, a very big job. He was vice chair of the antitrust section of the American Bar Association, and an expert and frequent lecturer on the Robinson-Patman Act, which I looked up because I wanted to know what that was. And what I discovered is that it was a very important law that outlawed price discrimination. He's also the author of several articles, as well as, and I'll show you, I'm told that this is the first edition, correct, Mr. Rosner, of a book that he co-authored with a gentleman named Frederick Chubach. It's called An Uncommon Friendship. You'll hear more about it. There's a moment in the book where Mr. Chubach recounts the recollection of a certain American soldier who served in Italy during World War II. And he describes this recollection as follows. I'm quoting from the book. Perhaps 1,000 survivors ready to show their tattooed number from Auschwitz, Mauthausen, Dachau, and other camps were there in Modena under British and American administration, along with some Palestinian Jewish soldiers who boosted their morale. What impressed this American soldier about the teenage Bernat was his energy, upbeat personality, and courtesy. He did not see in him so much the lost waif as I had assumed. Rather, Bernat Rosner appeared to the American GI as a youngster ready to take on the world, if only it gave him a chance. Shortly, Mr. Rosner himself will tell you more about that American GI who noticed him on that day in Italy and ultimately changed his life. It truly is a rare privilege to hear Mr. Rosner's story directly from him. We're so pleased and honored to have him back at TJ with us. And as he speaks, do be thinking of questions you might want to ask him. You can see the microphone set up over there. We'll question him at the end of his remarks, so you'll have that opportunity. But now, please join me in welcoming and listening to Bernat Rosner.
Can you all hear me? Okay? Great.
Is that good?
Yes, that's good. Well, thanks to head of school, Ms. Hollenkamp. Thank you for inviting me to talk to you today. Thanks for taking the time to listen, and hopefully, if time permits, give me a chance to answer any questions you may have, and if time permits. This is a very special occasion for me. Here in the precincts, in these precincts, where my American life began 70 years ago. It is here that I made my first American friends, including the great teacher and educator whose name these lecture series bear. I may add that back in those days, I think I was a junior or senior, and was a lowly sophomore, as I recall, when he and a friend of his ambushed me with a hail of snowballs. I called him an uncomplimentary name, and my apologies, belated apologies for that. It is here where, like you, I had the fortune and privilege of acquiring the values that this wonderful school represents. It is also here that I had to memorize reams of Shakespeare, which, as my wife Jan will bear out, I still spout out regularly whether the occasion calls for it or not. I may add that I was lucky or unlucky, depending on your perspective, to have escaped being deprived of the delights of having to recite Homer or Tacitus in Greek or Latin, because I was too busy learning English. But beyond these personal considerations, it is always a special occasion for me to be able to talk to young people. It is special for at least three reasons. First, you have to remember that when I landed on the train platform of the Auschwitz concentration camp and went through the horrors of the Holocaust, I was just 12 years old, probably a couple of years younger than men most of you here now. For that reason, I feel that young people like you can relate to what I went through and hopefully gain some inspiration and support from my story when you all face, and you will inevitably will face, some crises or problems, obviously, hopefully, nothing remotely as bad as what I faced. Second, I was among the youngest persons to survive the Holocaust, and I've just, quote, celebrated my 86th birthday. The obvious conclusion is that Holocaust survivors will be fewer and fewer as the years advance. This makes it, in my mind, a special occasion for both you and me. It is not very likely that too many students in the future will have a chance to hear the story of what happened from a person who actually lived those events. I think this is important because I believe you will agree that it makes a big difference between reading something in a history book and hearing it from the mouth of a person who actually lived through it. Third, you are the future. It will be up to you to hopefully make the world a better place and do your best to make sure that the horrors of the Holocaust and the continuing instances of genocide, terror, do not just keep repeating themselves. While the early part of my life was dominated by turmoil, upheaval, and horror, most of the latter part of it was spent under slightly more benign circumstances practicing law in California. The fact that I chose the law as a career is due to a number of reasons, but there is little question in my mind that after witnessing the breakdown of the basic norms of civilized behavior and the repudiation of decency, tolerance, human dignity, I was strongly drawn to a profession which ideally at least holds up as its goals the values that were so brutally trampled upon by the perpetrators of the Nazi atrocities. For almost 40 years following the war, I put the events and memories of that earlier period out of my mind. During those intervening years, I've heard and read about Holocaust survivors and even their children who would not talk or even think of the things that happened because the memories were too painful. I have to admit that this was not the case with me. I shut the past out simply because I did not consider it relevant. I was in a new country, starting a new life, and my focus has always been on the future, not the past. Then starting about the mid-1980s, 40 years after the war, two things happened that changed my attitude. First, I came to realize that you can't chop your life up into compartments and just listen to parts that you don't consider relevant. Your past is part of you, whether you like it or not. Second, in the spring of 1992, I attended the opening of the U.S. Holocaust Museum in Washington as a representative of the Safeway Food Company, who contributed a fair amount towards the construction. While there, and as part of a VIP tour, I was given access to the archives, including the log of prisoners entering the Mauthausen concentration camp. I started my concentration camp career in Auschwitz, but I knew that the Germans, knowing that hardly anybody would survive, they didn't bother to keep records and give numbers except to those, the numbers tattooed on their arms, unless they were selected for permanent work detail in Auschwitz, which I never was. So the curator of the museum brought me archives of the log of prisoners entering the Mauthausen concentration camp. As I stared at the microfiche, which is used to be the way that you recorded, was before the digital era, the documents that they had, I saw the following entry for September 19, 1944. Bernat Rosner, prisoner number 103705. As I looked at that banal bureaucratic notation, the floodgates of memory and emotion opened and overwhelmed me. In that respect, you must remember that there is not a picture, a document, or any tangible thing that connects me to my former life. The upshot of these reflections and experience was a decision to tell my story. When I was ready to do so, a series of coincidences, which in their own way are as unique as any other aspect of my life, brought it about that I met a man who's by the name of Fritz Tubach, whose background and history could not have been more different from mine. His father, Fritz's father, was a Nazi, and Fritz himself, in his early youth, was a member of the Jungvolk, the Cub Scout equivalent of the Hitler Youth. By the time we met in the 1980s, we had both become Americans. We both accepted the principle that you are responsible for your own actions and not for those of your father or other members of your nation or race. Over the years, we formed a friendship. We discovered we both had interesting stories to tell, and we decided to tell our stories together. The result was a book called An Uncommon Friendship. The reason for the title is by now obvious, which has enjoyed a fair degree of success, has been translated into German, Italian, and Dutch, and which is one of the reasons why I'm talking to you here today. The rest of what I have to say will consist mainly of telling you something about myself, where I came from, what I went through, and how I ended up where I did. I was born 86 years ago in a smallish town by the name of Tub in rural Hungary. For the first 12 years of my life, I had a basically normal and happy childhood. An important part of my personality and makeup was shaped by the rigor and discipline of a Jewish Orthodox upbringing and a sensitive and literate mother. Both of these influences imbued me with an abiding love for books and learning. Anti-Semitism was certainly not unknown in Hungary, and it existed in a good measure in our village as far back as I can remember. It was institutional in terms of laws that restricted the freedom of Jews from practicing certain professions or owning land and limiting the number of Jews who could be admitted to law, medical, and other professional schools. It was also personal in terms of Jews being bullied and held up to contempt and hostility, not by any means by all of the non-Jewish population, but by a substantial segment of the community, many of whom were members or followers of the Hungarian version of the Nazi and similar racist parties, factions. While this was not the virulent and deadly doctrine of extermination as practiced and preached by Hitler and his thugs, and the anti-Semitic undercurrents running through Hungarian political and cultural life did not significantly affect my everyday life and my basically happy and normal childhood. It was obviously a different childhood that you had. Our whole town had one automobile that belonged to the local landowner, and I think maybe two people had radios, and we had outdoor plumbing. All this changed with dramatic suddenness on a very specific date, March 19, 1944, relatively late in the course of World War II. I remember the day very well. I was on my way home from a study session in preparation for my upcoming bar mitzvah when a neighbor woman asked if I had heard the news. When I asked what news, she told me that the Germans had taken over the country and the government. The effect of the Nazi takeover on the Jews of Hungary were immediate and disastrous. I will limit my account to what happened to me, to my family, and the Jewish community of Tub. Okay. Hopefully that's better. Great, great. Okay. The effects of the Nazi takeover in Jews of Hungary were immediate and disastrous. Within days following the takeover, the stream of anti-Jewish edicts began. Jews could not travel without specific permission. Soon they could not travel at all. Prominent families and those who were suspected of subversive activities or associations began to disappear. By mid-April, all Jews had to wear a yellow star on their outer clothing. I remember the evening before this edict went into effect, my mother sitting in our small living room, sewing yellow stars on our sweaters and jackets. By mid-May, all Jews were herded into a ghetto. My family was lucky in that respect. Our home was within the area that was designated as part of the ghetto, but our three-room home, instead of just housing my immediate family, also became home for numerous relatives, at least between, as I recall, between 16 to 18 persons in all, whose homes were outright outside the ghetto boundaries. The end of the Jewish community in Tub came during the latter part of June 1944. On 24 hours' notice, we were ordered to be ready for departure in front of our homes with no more than one suitcase per person. Three images stand out for me from the day on which we were marched down the main street of Tub to the unused brickyard next to the railroad station. The first was the attitude and behavior of the non-Jewish inhabitants. A relatively small number of them stood on the streets and were making jeers like, "You Jews are finally getting what is coming to you." The great majority of the town people simply retired into their homes, closed their shutters, and shut out the sight of their fellow citizens being marched, driven down the street like cattle. The second memory is my witnessing the humiliation of my mother on the way to the railroad station, at all places at a public school, when I witnessed her humiliation of being stripped naked in a crowded room and hand-searched by Nazi thugs. The third was at the brickyard with only bare earthen floor for accommodations when an elderly woman standing up to recite the Sabbath prayers was clubbed bloody and unconscious by one of the guards. Now, worse things happened later, but you have to imagine a young person leading a relatively normal life in the span of one day being steeped into this kind of a nightmare. From Tub, we were shipped to a collection point about 50 miles away, where we were unloaded onto a large open field. There, we were joined by approximately 7,000 to 10,000 other Jews collected from other ghettos in that part of Hungary. From there, during the first week of July 1944, we were loaded into cattle cars, between 50 to 60 men, women, and children per car, headed for Auschwitz. We arrived at Auschwitz-Birkenau on approximately July 7. I looked it up in a calendar, and it was a Friday. By the time the sliding door of the freight car, which remained locked throughout the five-day journey, was opened, there were at least a half dozen corpses or near corpses in the car, and many more whose minds became unhinged. On the train platform at Auschwitz, there was chaos, brutality, and confusion, but my immediate family, my mother, my father, my kid brother, and I were still together. The first thing that happened was an announcement on the loudspeakers that all those in charge of the cattle cars had to report somewhere. My father was designated as being in charge of our car, though what his duties were, he never knew, and I didn't know. So he left us, and I never saw him again. Next, there was an announcement that men and women should separate because showers would be given. By this time, my mother became quite frightened and asked us told us to stay with her. Being a 12-year-old, I told her I wasn't about to take a shower with a bunch of women. She didn't argue with me, but her last words to me were, "Whatever you do, stick with your little brother." Next, all the males were lined up in a line. At the head of the line were two SS men. And as each person reached the head of the line, they were sent either to the left or the right. My brother, who was just 10 years old, was ahead of me. The Nazi looked at him and without hesitation sent him to the left. Harking back to my mother's admonition, I followed him. I was about three steps past the Nazi when he picked me up by the scruff of the neck and shoved me over to the right. To this day, I don't know whether he did this because he was angry that I made my own decision instead of being told what to do. Or he looked me over and said, maybe we can get some work out of this one. He knew very well that later on there were further screenings down the line, and that if I was judged to be unfit for work, I would be taken care of then. In any event, that shove from the left to the right made the difference on that day between my ending up in the gas chambers, as did the rest of my family, and my surviving that, at least that initial screening process. My ordeal obviously did not end with that fateful shove. Every day for the next 10 months until my liberation by the Americans during the first week of May 1945 was a battle for survival. That battle took several forms. At first in Auschwitz, it was a matter of trying to avoid being sent to the gas chambers. This was because even though I survived that initial screening, I kept flunking the physicals that the prisoners were subjected to in order to qualify for a permanent work assignment. By mid-September of 1944, I realized that most of those remaining in my barracks consisted of the old, the sick, and those like me, too young to be selected for work. At that point, in a desperate move that is described in the book, I managed to get into a transport out of Auschwitz to the Mauthausen concentration camp in Austria. Ironically, in the annals of the Holocaust, Mauthausen is described, rightly so, as one of the most brutal of the concentration camps, and it was. But for me, it was a lifesaver, because there you were put sent to the gas chamber only if you were unable to do any work or got sick. From then on, my battle for survival was mostly a matter of fighting and trying to survive hunger, cold, brutal beating, overcrowding, unsanitary conditions, and almost every other privation known to man. To illustrate, let me give you a picture of a typical day in the Mauthausen concentration camp. I will start with bedtime in the evening. Our sleeping accommodations were triple-decker bunk beds. But instead of one person per bed, we were squeezed three, sometimes four persons per bed. The result was horrible overcrowding, with people fighting with each other for every inch of available space. There was no mattress on the beds, sometimes some filthy ground-up straw, often just the wooden boards. One night, I offered a deal to my bunk mates. If they let me have the single blanket we were allotted, I would go down and sleep under the on the floor under the bed and free up some space on the bed for the rest of them. My offer was accepted, and that was as much of a win-win situation as you could have in Mauthausen. We were woken up about 6:30 in the morning, mostly with shouts, but if the overseers thought we were not quick enough, then with clubs. Our barracks, housing about 100 men, had two faucets and one three-hole latrine for our sanitation needs. By 7, we had to be outside the barracks and line up for roll call. We had to stand and wait for the German to show up and receive a roll call report from the barracks chief. Sometimes the German would not show up for an hour or more, and we had to stand there in the rain or snow or bitter cold, and this was by now getting to be October and November, until the German showed up. In these months of late fall, we only had thin striped prisoners' uniform for clothing. Frankly, I don't even remember what we had any underwear. After roll call, we had breakfast, which consisted of a brown lukewarm liquid they called coffee. After breakfast, the able-bodied prisoners were sent out on work details. Since I was small and frail-looking, I generally was not picked for work. Instead, all of those who were not picked up for work had to stay outside, often in the freezing cold. To ease our discomfort, we huddled against each other for body heat. One amusement of the more brutal overseeing guards were to start beating the outer layer of this huddled mass with clubs and watch the whole group break into a stampede. In the course of these stampedes, my feet got trampled on, resulting in cold sores that never healed during my time in the camps, and I still have the scars on my feet. For lunch, we were served, and I'm glad you already had your lunch. We were served a cup of greasy liquid called soup, made out of dried beets and with dead maggots floating in the liquid. Our dinner consisted of a slice of bread with a square of margarine or a scoop of jam. During my 10 months of imprisonment, I never had a glass of milk or a piece of fruit. The only exception was one day when we were carrying airplane parts on a public street and the woman was walking ahead of us eating an apple. She looked around furtively to see that there were no guards looking and then threw the half-eaten apple on the ground. I was the lucky one who picked up the apple, took a good-sized bite, and shared the apple with my best friend. To add to our misery, the unsanitary conditions resulted in an enormous infestation of lice. We spent much of our day squirming and scratching, and our evenings trying to kill the vermin that were crawling on our clothing. A very large number of prisoners contracted typhus as a result of the lice, and many of them died of the disease. I too contracted the disease, but fortunately, the symptoms did not show up until after I was liberated by the Americans in early May of 1945 and was cared for and recovered in an American field hospital. When I woke up after 7 days of lying unconscious, I was put on a scale, and at the age of 13, I weighed 26 kilos, or about 52 pounds. Following the war, there were many pictures or images in magazines and newsreels showing the cadaver-like creatures that emerged from the concentration camps upon liberation by the Allies. I was one of them. With all the brutality and deprivation, there were instances of humanity and selflessness, sometimes from unexpected quarters. Let me give you two examples. The first involved a German soldier who was one of our guards when we were being moved from the Auschwitz to the Mauthausen concentration camp. The journey was by train in cattle cars, but the conditions were not nearly as terrible as those on the trip to Auschwitz that I already described. There were about 30 male prisoners per car. We had adequate sanitation and water and meager but regular meals. The guard with his rifle was quartered with us in the cattle car. During the first day of the three-day trip, he was distant and unfriendly. By the second day, he unbent a little, and for some reason, he took a liking to me. By that evening, he offered me some morsels from his dinner, which, of course, was far superior to what the prisoners had. Later that evening, he asked me to sing some songs that I remembered from my childhood. I felt that somehow, in that cattle car, taking me to the next concentration camp, this German soldier and I had formed a bond. The second instance of some light in the dark days of my captivity involved my best friend and me. you could not possibly survive the physical and emotional trauma of the camps without a buddy system, a friend to lean on and give support to and receive support from. In my case, I found a boy about my age in Mauthausen, the second camp I was in, and we both felt that we made a good fit. The name of this boy was Simcha, and there is a picture of the two of us in the book, which is taken shortly after the war. One night in the middle of the winter, someone stole Simcha's shoes while we were sleeping. The shoes were not much. They were basically flip-flops with wooden soles. But they were all we had, and they were certainly better than nothing. So the following morning, Simcha had to walk barefoot through the snow and ice to the factory where we were working, about a mile away. While at work, the thief, another bigger boy, came up to us and said, "Guess what? I found your shoes, and if you give me your day's ration of bread, you can have them back." Simcha and I both knew that he could not possibly survive without his shoes, and neither could he survive without his ration of bread. The only solution was to try to make it for the day with a half ration of bread for each of us, and to use the other ration to retrieve his shoes. We did this without discussion or question. We both took it for granted that he would do the same for me if it was necessary. People asked me if there was any, if were any good days in the camps, and I tell them it was the day that I saved my friend's life with a slice of bread. Very briefly, I will tell you how I ended up where I am and how a chance encounter in the summer of 1945 changed and gave a new direction to my life. By that time, with the war in Europe over, I was in a refugee camp in Italy in the town of Modena. I was alone, just over 13 years old, ragged and hungry. There were thousands of kids like me hustling for an extra piece of bread. We didn't have to worry anymore of being sent to the gas chambers, but life was pretty grim. So we were getting enough to eat, and if we were really lucky, some candy or a piece of chewing gum. The only source of those goodies was the American soldiers who were stationed near our camp. So naturally, I spent much of my time hanging out near where the Americans were billeted. As I was standing there one day looking for a hustling opportunity, a Jeep drove up loaded with four GIs and their duffel bags. I immediately ran up to the Jeep, headed for the nearest soldier, and with sign language offered my services as a porter. The GI smiled at me and pointed at his duffel bag. The bag was almost as big as I was, and my employer later told me that all he could see as he was following me was the bag and my two bare feet underneath pumping away with great energy. After I delivered the bag to his room, the soldier gave me a chocolate bar, which was at that point the main and chief objective of my agenda, but we started to try to communicate. We found out that the only way of doing so was broken German. I briefly told him my story. The words Mutter, Vater, kaputt by then slid off my tongue quite easily. And he was visibly and deeply moved. For the next 5 days, he spent all of his time with me, taking me to the movies, the restaurant, treats I've never had before. We also did a lot of walking and talking. There is a picture in the book of the two of us taken by a street photographer. 5 days after I met him, the soldier was transferred, but we started corresponding with each other. The upshot of this encounter was that after the soldier returned to the U.S. and was demobilized from the service, he wrote me a letter offering to bring me to the U.S. and to have me become part of his family. This story by itself is unique enough, but what makes it even more remarkable for both me and you is that the name of this GI happened to be Charles Merrill, the co-founder of this great school, my teacher, my mentor, role model, friend, and benefactor. I guess the rest, you might say, is history. When Fritz and I first embarked on our joint project, my intention was not to send a moral message. My intention was simply to tell my story because I realized that I had some obligations to fulfill. First and foremost was an obligation to my three children who grew up in a suburban town in outside of San Francisco. As they grew up, they heard bits and pieces of my story, but never in a coherent or systematic way. And I realize now that I kept the details and the more important, the emotions out of the story more to protect myself than protect them. I also owed a debt to the family I lost, my mother, my father, my kid brother, and my extended family. The story of the Holocaust, how the millions were murdered, has been told many times, but their own personal story has never been told. I deserve that that be done and that it was up to me to do it. I also felt that my story was a good and fascinating yarn that was worth telling. With all the horrors and suffering, there were moments of tension, suspense, and adventure. The old truism that often truth is stranger than fiction is, I believe, applicable to many aspects of both of our stories. But even though the story was not told to send a moral message, I believe it does so nevertheless, and it does so on several levels. The one that I believe is particularly relevant today is the ability to two individuals who come from their starkly different beginnings to be able to surmount the walls that could have divided them, to look beyond the conventional mindset that could have made them, if not hate, at least distrust each other, and enable them to form a friendship. Instead of being adversaries or strangers, they decided to ignore labels and join forces to tell what I hope and believe is a warm and inspiring story. Thank you.
What I'll do is hold the mic at this point. Thank you so much. That was an incredible, riveting story, which I hope we'll capture in a variety of ways. We've been live streaming it. It will be archived for people to listen to revisit, and I hope that you will share your written transcript with us so we're able to publish it as well. We would really appreciate it. You've given us so much to think about. It's just an amazing journey. And I hope that all of you picked up on the moment when Mr. Rosner identified the American soldier who gave him the chocolate bar. Did you pick up on that? Mr. Charles Merrill, one of our founders, and whom we are going to remember and honor tomorrow. So all of this is connected. It's an amazing story. And are you ready for some questions? Okay, he is ready for some questions. So if anyone has a question, please. Who's going to have the courage to be the first? Come on, TJ students, you are never shy. Okay, Mason, come up to the microphone if you would. This is Mason.
Hello? Okay. That was truly an inspiring story, but I wanted to ask,
I will. Okay. I'm because we need to sort of transfer from you to here. Keep going.
Oh.
So Mason okay. said that he found that to be a really inspiring story. All right. Continue,
yeah.
Mason.
Are you still in contact with your friend that you said you shared your bread with in the camp?
He wants to know if you're still in contact with the friend whose life you saved with a slice of bread.
Yes, I am. He was not lucky enough to carry a bag for Mr. Merrill, and he ended up in Israel, and I saw him in Jerusalem about in 1996, and we reminisced. It was a very emotional encounter. And then in 2006, he and his wife came to the U.S. to visit, and he looked me up, and we spent 4 days together, and we had, again, a very emotional time. He is one of the few people in Israel who doesn't speak English, and I have forgotten, or certainly not able to speak fluently, any of the languages that we shared, which was Hungarian and Hebrew. But fortunately, his son can act as a translator, and I send him emails from time to time, use the Google Translate to try to come up with the right Hebrew words. So that's the answer.
Thank you, Mason. Do you have another question, or is that it?
This might be not very relevant, but I remember hearing a story from another Auschwitz survivor who said the soup color was green.
Okay, he remembers hearing a story from another Holocaust survivor who said the color of the soup was green. And you were wondering about that? Yes?
Well,
green soup, or you said brown.
No, well, the suits were prisoners.
Are you talking about soup or soup? In the soup that you ate.
The soup. The soup. Well, it was basically a kind of a, it's like dishwater probably is the best way to describe the color as I remember it. And probably it was an upgrade of the quality if it was dishwater instead of the soup that we had. But obviously we ate it hungrily because hunger is, all the other things happen and sometimes they stop happening, but hunger is with you all the time. And that was kind of overwhelming. That's why I may mention that when we found out that we were liberated, which time we found out because somebody came in our barracks and said all the guards are gone, instead of marching around celebrating, we headed for the warehouse, which had these maggot-ridden dried beets. We ripped open the sacks and just stuffed our mouth full of food, if you can call it food. I remember my first night of freedom scratching myself from the lice and sleeping on one of those sacks.
That was it's very inspiring.
He thanks you and says it's very inspiring. All right, who's next? Is that Sarah's hand I see back there? Come on, Sarah. Okay. So we'll turn this way a little bit. Maybe if we come, Bernie. Maybe if we come to this side.
Okay. So, as someone whose life was changed by Mr. Merrill, I'm just curious to hear how did you feel when you first heard from him and the offer he made for you.
She wants to know more about your relationship with Mr. Merrill. What was it like at the very beginning? And how did you get to know him? How did you feel about it when he made the offer to you to come to the U.S.?
Well, I was overwhelmed. I really was. By then we had exchanged. Can you all hear me? I have the trouble of. Okay. Right. Okay. I did not expect this, and when he wrote me the letter, I also have that letter, It was about November of 1945. I try to be accurate on dates. Among other things, because the allegations of that the people, I can't believe how they do it, but they say the Holocaust never happened. And I think that being precise and specific is not to rebut these allegations or the claims, because they're too silly to accept, but I do feel that accuracy and precision is part of my life. To answer that question, just beginning with his letters. I was at that point in a refugee camp, which was also a very grim place. And at one point I wrote him a letter that I was very unhappy and I didn't know what to do. And he arranged through contacts in Italy for me to lodge and board with a family in one of the towns of Italy between the fall of 1946-47 and my coming to the U.S. in January of 1948. After that, he was a kind of a unique man. He was always kind, of course, but he had kind of funky, not the conventional kind of ideas. Among other things, in March of 1948, about 3 months after I was here, he thought a good experience would be, for me, is to hitchhike from St. Louis to New Orleans for my spring vacation. The other thing to show what kind of a person he was, he knew very well that I had to start learning English as soon as possible. And while I was still in Italy, he took a very direct approach, which was to send me a copy of the book, Robert Louis Stevenson's book, Treasure Island. I don't know if you had to read it in class, and a Hungarian English dictionary. Now, Hungary was a totally landlocked country. And when I was reading about capstans and mizzenmasts, I don't know if there was any translation, but even after translation, I didn't know what it meant. And you may remember, if you read the book, that on the first page there's that ditty about six men on a dead man's trunk, yo-ho-ho, and a bottle of rum. You can imagine how much fun I had trying to translate that. By the time I came to the U.S. in January of 48, I was up to, I think, page 26. But the Treasure Island still has a very special meaning to me. He was that kind of a person, a mixture of kindness and basically thinking out of the box, you might say.
How do I talk? Can I just talk like this? Is this fine? Okay, cool. Okay, like this? Fantastic. Bottom one. Oh, that's much better. I'm just gonna kneel a little. So my question was, what kept you going through your ears during the concentration camps?
The question is, what kept you going during those years in the concentration camps?
There were a couple of things. There were a couple of things, or more than maybe a couple. The first was, as I said, I was raised in an Orthodox Jewish family. I am not religious now, but I was then, and there's no question in my mind that my religion, my faith, was a huge factor in giving me hope and perseverance. The other thing was that I was able to adapt. The other thing was, among other things, is that I was 12 years old and I just stopped growing. youngsters who were even a few years older, whose bodies kept growing, they contracted tuberculosis or some other disease and couldn't make it. And finally, I'm a survivor in a lot of ways. Dodging bullets has been my specialty, and I hunkered down. I have to tell you, and I say that to people, people call me tough, but the fact is that the division between being tough and callous is not a bright line. And to be quite honest, if you were a sensitive person, you couldn't survive. You couldn't survive both emotionally and physically. What you saw, what you experienced, simply would not let you survive. So call it toughness or call it callousness. That was definitely another reason why I was able to make it.
Thank you.
Sure.
I'd like to ask, is it hard for you to talk about what your experience is?
She'd like to know if it's hard for you, even today, to talk about these experiences.
Well, I've just, as after the book, I've talked so many times. There are times when, yes, I do get emotional, and I have to tell, there are two times when it really hit me. One is when I saw my name in the logbook in Mauthausen, and the other in 2006, when I, the first time, visited Auschwitz. The first and only time I visited Auschwitz. And to see, by that time, of course, much of the old camp was razed and not there, but that famous, I don't know if any of you have seen the movie called Schindler's List, and the pictures of Auschwitz, there's that gate through which the trains came. I saw it, and I remember seeing it when that's the gate through which we came, where we were unloaded. And when I went in there, and actually our guide during the trip said, you know better than I do what happened. I talked. But then also, there was the barracks that I was in Auschwitz. Most, they were all gone except one, a prototype one, and it brought back incredible memories. It's something that is part of my life, and I accept it. And in my youth, when I was growing up here in the States, I basically shoved the things away, and I tell you, because I thought I was in America and starting this new life. But obviously, there were some other reasons why I didn't want to talk about it and deal with it until about almost 40 years after the war.
Lisa, I have a question from thank you. I have a question from someone that's viewing in, and it's an intense one. So for the Holocaust Remembrance Day in April, there was a survey that was done that 41% of Americans and 66% of millennials could not correctly identify what Auschwitz was. The question to you is, how do we combat that ignorance?
This is a question that has come from someone who's watching us online, and it has to do with the level of ignorance about Auschwitz, that a very high percentage of people in our culture, and especially millennials of a certain age, young people, have never heard of Auschwitz. They don't know what it is. And what are we to do to combat that?
Well, that's a question that, to some extent, I have a little, might say, disagreement, because I have been literally hundreds of times talking to both young people, high schools, and older groups. And just this morning, a alumnus of Thomas Jefferson School, a local man, took us through the Holocaust Museum here in St. Louis, and there was a bunch of youngsters from Centralia, was it? From Centralia, Illinois, who came to visit the Holocaust Museum. I think that people's memories kind of are short, but I do feel that the Holocaust, what happened, has, I think, changed, at least in the civilized world, the issue of what we stand for, what are the values we stand for, and how, very importantly, how a civilized country like Germany, with its incredible treasured painters, writers, composers, how it could descend to the level that it did. So I think that what happened during that time is going to be, I think it has made a significant impact on how the world, or at least the civilized world, looks at issues of genocide, at issues of human dignity, and the dangers of slipping into abyss of bigotry and intolerance.
Hi, Mr. Posner. Question for you. Have you ended up having a bar mitzvah? You said that you were raised Orthodox and you turned 13 when all of that took place, and then you came to the United States and now you no longer practice a Jew. That doesn't mean you're no longer a Jew. You're still a Jew. And question remains, have you ever continued having the faith in God? You know, continuous traditions, because no matter how it's spelled, whether you're not or you are a practicing Jew, the fact remains that traditions of our religion is what keeps us alive. And myself, not a practicing one, my kids are going through bat mitzvahs because this is our traditions and this is what's important. So the question to you, have you ever considered, or did you have a bar mitzvah?
This has to do with your religious upbringing and tradition. And she wants to know if you had ever considered having a bar mitzvah.
Well, I think it's something that happens at a certain stage of your life. And I was actually in another concentration camp on my 13th birthday. It's the kind of thing that I felt, and particularly religion, you do it at the age of 13, and really I never had an occasion. My buddy Simcha and I shared our bread and kind of paid homage to my bar mitzvah, but that was in the Gusen concentration camp, and that was where I observed it, and I did not have a substitute bar mitzvah.
Thank you. All right. Ooh, well, thank you again, Mr. Rosner, for sharing your story with us. Many of you, I hope, most of you, all of you, will be able to come back to this very space tomorrow at 10 o'clock when we will celebrate the life and the legacy of Charles Merrill. We'll have the pleasure of hearing from Bernie again at that time, and from others. So thank you again for coming to this lecture. You've given us much food for thought. We have a copy of the book. If anyone is interested in borrowing, we're certainly happy to acquire more. So thank you again, and let's give Mr. Rosner a final round of applause.